make a visiting with us. We ask all of you, whether you're a first-time visitor, a long-time member, or somewhere in between, if you'll sign the registration pad that you find at the end of your row, we might have a record of your attendance with us on this Lord's Day. We appreciate that. We are indeed glad that you are here this day. We have a lot of things going on. We want to call your attention to the announcements that are in the bulletin. Is there anything else we need to lift up announcement-wise this morning? If not, let's begin with a word of prayer. Gracious and loving God, thank you for another beautiful Sunday morning which we come together to worship you in spirit and in truth in this beautiful place. Lord, we know that you are among us. Make us aware of your presence here. Thank you for all gathered, and we pray for those not with us this day. And Lord, now we lift up all that we say and do here for your glory and your honor. And we ask this in your name and for your sake. Amen. Let us worship now in spirit and in truth.
Amen. Let's stand and worship our Lord this morning. Not only did Jesus rise again after the crucifixion, but his spirit within us wants to lift us up after our crucifixions and struggles and sufferings of this life. We can rise with Christ. Here we go.
One, two, three.
There's a peace I come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave.
Yeah.
Let's turn and greet one another in the name of the Lord this morning. This next song is a prayer, praying for just a pure heart to come before the Lord.
Give me one pure and holy passion. Give me one magnificent obsession. Give me one glorious ambition for my life, to know and follow hard after you.
Let's do it together now, come on. Give me
one pure and holy passion. Give me one magnificent obsession. Give me one glorious ambition for my life, to know and follow hard after you.
To know and follow hard.
To know and follow hard after you. To grow as your disciple in your truth. This world is empty, pale, and poor. Compared to knowing you, my Lord, lead me on and I will run after you. Lead me on and I will run after you. Give me one pure and passion. Give me one magnificent obsession. Give me one glorious ambition for my life, to know and follow hard after you.
This is our prayer.
To know and follow hard after you. Your disciple in your truth. This world is empty, pale, and poor. Compared to knowing you, my Lord, lead me on and I will run after you. Lead me on and I will run after you. To know and follow hard after you. Disciple in your truth, this world is empty, pale, and poor. Compared to knowing you, my Lord, lead me on, and I will run after you. Lead me on, and I will run after you.
Thank you.
are those storms in this life. And sometimes you darest to step out on faith and walk upon the water, even out there in the deep water. And sometimes, Lord, we take our eyes off of you and we start to sink. May we remember there's two kinds of faith. The faith that steps out on the water, and the faith that when we're sinking, cries out to the one who can save us. Give us strength for the challenges ahead. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. We'll begin praise and prayer in a moment. We'll start to my right, to your left, over here. But first, for those of you who were here the last time I did praise and prayers, you remember my reading a few paragraphs from William Young's new book, Crossroads. The reading gave some insight into the afterlife. Young is the author of The Shack, if you don't remember. I'm not reading you today, but later in the book there appeared a discussion about one of the real mysteries of Christianity. It's about how we get our head around this three persons of the Trinity into one God. It describes something that we talk about often. We talk about often in sermons and in Sunday school. We talk about relationships. The Young suggests an extremely strong relationship between the Son, the Father, and the Spirit. One developed to a high level of trust, total openness, complete honesty, and absolute love. This strong relationship brings them so close to one another that they appear as oneness. So that when you look upon Jesus, you see the Father and the Spirit. And when you feel the Spirit, you are in the company of Jesus and the Father. And when you gaze upon the Father, Jesus and the Spirit are in the same frame. So you see three persons so tightly bound to one another that they appear as one God. I thought that insight was worth sharing. That's how relationships work. We're often encouraged to build a strong relationship with Jesus beyond the obvious benefit of being in touch with our Savior. When someone looks at us, they just might get a glimpse of the Jesus that we know so well. And that's just how relationships work. So, prayer and praise. This side. Anybody? Well, we're quiet this morning. In the middle? No, I didn't scare y'all. Come on, talk. There's no need for prayer, and all the praises are great. Lee.
I would like to ask for praises and prayers for our military and our military families and all of our first responders who give day after day to us to keep us safe and healthy.
Thank you, Lee. We're getting a mic. Just a second.
I'd like to ask prayers for my son, Layton. We're taking him to Camp Trinity today. Just pray that he has a great week and becomes closer to God. Thank you.
Super.
Some dear friends of ours, excuse me, they just had the children had a baby, and she was born about 6 weeks too early. So just keeping my prayer, Everly Garrison.
Yes. Judy's getting there.
The exercise.
I would like to ask for prayers for our granddaughter, Nicole, the princess, who is on her way to Guatemala and a group of young people for 10 days for safety and guidance and protection.
You're out of time. You were supposed to be over here before. Okay. Jim's coming. Hold on.
You did this.
I would just like to thank God for helping somebody invent air conditioning.
And I'll add one last praise. I'll praise the Lord that this happens to be the last day of my 73rd year, because tomorrow is my birthday. Was there anybody else? Did I miss anybody? Someone's waving their hand. Oh, my goodness.
Happy birthday, Grandpa.
Thank you, sweetheart. Shall we close with the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
If the young people will please join me up front here, we'll have a little time with the children. I want to pick up on something that Mr. Bill just said in his little words there. I don't know whether y'all were paying attention, but what Mr. McAdams, one of the things he was talking about was how sometimes when people look at us, they can see God in us. Wow, that's a pretty amazing thought. Sometimes when people look at us, they might see other things. If we're misbehaving or something like that, they may look at us and go, oh my goodness. But when would be a time when somebody might look at us and see God in us? Or maybe God's love in us. When would that happen? What might we be doing at that time? What do you think? While you're thinking, go ahead, Lily. Yeah.
Helping somebody, like, with their homework.
Absolutely. If somebody needs help with their homework and you take some of your time and you help them, then you're showing kindness. And that is certainly something that allows somebody to see Christ in you. Yep. You got one? You guys keep thinking. Let me ask you this. Sure. Have you ever done that for somebody? Helped somebody do that? Maybe. Yeah. Have you ever seen God in somebody else when they did something and you thought, wow, I can see God in them? Yeah? Can you think of an example? When somebody, your sister helped you? Good. Yeah. When we help one another, when we do something kind for somebody, when we love, when we share love with others, it's God through us loving. Now, I want to push you just a little bit farther. What if it's somebody that you don't necessarily like? What if it's somebody that's really, really different than you? What if it's somebody that it's not easy to show love to, but you do it anyway? Boy, that's really being Christ to them. Can you remember a time when you were nice to somebody that maybe wasn't nice to you, or you forgave somebody that had done you wrong, or you said a prayer for somebody that maybe, you know, you had a, yeah? Can you remember? Uh-huh. You stood up for somebody who maybe hadn't been so nice, but they needed a friend. Okay. I think any time that you or I show kindness, show love, reach out to somebody. Yes.
I got one for the last question.
Okay.
You can help your mom and dad around the house.
Absolutely. Helping your mom and dad around the house. That's a way to show Christ's love to your parents and respect to them. Absolutely. All right, I'm going to give you one more chance. Can you think of some times that you did something for somebody that maybe didn't deserve it? Your parents deserve it. But what about somebody, maybe somebody was being bullied and you didn't particularly like them either, but you stuck up for them or you were a friend? Okay, all right. Yes, that's right. That's right, picking up trash and things like that for others. All right, well, let's have a prayer, okay? Dear God, help us to show your love and your kindness and your forgiveness so when others look at us, they might see you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, you can be seated.
It's good to see you this morning. And it is good to be seen. It's a little something that I've done with congregations in the past. When I've said it's good to see you, they have said it's good to see you. And I say it's good to be seen. So that's why I do that. It's amazing to open the Word of God and to see the layer upon layer upon layer of meaning and importance for our lives. We look at it at the surface and we think we got everything. Yeah, I got the message here. I know exactly what you're saying, Lord. And yet there's even a deeper message underneath and a deeper message underneath. And I found myself dealing with that this week with our text. I thought to myself that Jim and I probably at some point maybe ought to do a little series entitled Things That Make You Go, Because I think this particular story has that sort of an aspect to it. On the surface, we think we've got the idea of what Jesus is trying to tell us here, but I think there's an even deeper meaning that makes us sit there and go, And I hope that we can uncover some of that this morning. I want to share the Word of God with you from the 12th chapter of the book of Luke, the Gospel of Luke. We're going to begin at verse 13. We're going to go to verse 21. Now, this is an episode that's following some really important teaching that Jesus is doing about the nature of the kingdom, the nature of discipleship, really focusing on some important things for us as kingdom citizens. And, you know, sometimes there's folks in the crowd that just don't get it. There's somebody in the crowd that just doesn't get it. And they interrupt Jesus, sort of like a commercial break, I guess, if you will. But Jesus uses this as an opportunity to proclaim a powerful truth that we need to really take in for our lives. So I hope you'll join me now as we sort of dig a little deeper here and get to that point where we go, Beginning verse 13, these from the Gospel of according to Luke. One of the multitude said to him, "Teacher, bid my brother divide the inheritance with me." And this is not unusual. In those days, when people had a dispute, they would often go to a religious leader, and the religious leader was supposed to settle the dispute. "Preacher, settle this issue for us." Oh boy. Jesus is supposed to settle this issue. "Bid my brother divide the inheritance with me." But he said to him, "Man, who made me a judge or divider over you?" And he said to him, "Take heed and beware of all covetousness, for a man's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions." And he told them a parable, saying, "The land of a rich man brought forth plentifully. And he thought to himself, 'What shall I do? For I have nowhere to store my crop.' crops. Tough problem. And he said, I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build larger ones. And there I will store all my grain and my goods, and I will say to my soul, soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Take your ease. Eat, drink, be merry. But God said to him, fool, this night your soul is required of you, and the things you have prepared, whose will they be? So is he who lays up treasures for himself and is not rich toward God. Beloved, the word of God for the people of God in the house of God. Thanks be to God. The Reverend Greg Osimakopoulos, in an article in Christian Reader entitled Rolling Down the Aisle, tells a story about a wedding he once performed. Now, the groom was an amateur golf champion, so Greg decided that in the wedding sermon, he would use an illustration about golf, complete with a golf ball. And so he asked the best man, can you bring a golf ball to the service tomorrow? And they go, sure. Well, the next day, right before the processional, Greg turns to the best man and says, did you remember the golf ball? Smiling broadly, the best man put his hand in his pocket and pulled out the golf ball. And almost immediately, as soon as he'd done that, a look of fear and panic crossed his face. You see, he had remembered the golf ball, but he forgot the bride's ring. Hey, you reckon the bride gave the best man a mulligan for that? Not so sure. I'm pretty sure some of us are sitting out here this morning having a fair degree of empathy for that poor best man. I mean, after all, we've all had moments when we've forgotten something, right? Yeah. And there we go. Thank you, Brother Bill. And no wonder. We live at a fast-paced world, a place where we face an ever-rising, ever-changing tide of data and details that we're supposed to take in and retain. It's easy to be a little bit absent-minded in the face of that information overload, and in a time in the life of our culture where the average attention span in any given instance has gone down about 25% over a decade to where it's now about 8 seconds in any one instant. That's according to a study from Microsoft. Yeah, we get a little absent-minded. But you need to understand there's a world of difference between being absent-minded and being forgetful. Losing sight of what matters most. Losing sight of what really counts. It's great the best man remembered the golf ball. Fantastic. But he forgot he was the best man. And one of the most important tasks of the best man is to remember the ring. Now, this kind of forgetfulness, this kind of losing sight of what really counts, what really matters most, I think that that is at the root of a lot of the sorrow, brokenness, and the pain that we have in our world this morning. And it is a danger that also has eternal consequences. Indeed, the whole of Scripture and of human history gives us ample examples of individuals who have forgotten what really counts, with disastrous consequences not only for them, but for others as well. And so this morning we find Jesus in this parable sort of highlighting for us the folly of that kind of behavior. I want us to think about that as he, I believe, warns us in this parable about the dangers of the sin of forgetfulness. Now, as I read to you, this man has interrupted Jesus in the middle of his teaching of a multitude and said, I want you to settle a personal wrong for me, Jesus. Tell my brother to give me more money from the family inheritance. And Jesus responds, as he often did, with a parable. He tells the story of a very wealthy farmer who has a really great year. And he's got a problem. He doesn't have a place to store his crops. He's got so much. Well, he has a brilliant idea. I'll just tear down what I got and build bigger. And then he says to himself, just take it easy. You got plenty for years to come. Relax, eat, drink, and be merry. And then Jesus tells us that that very night, God comes to him, calls him a fool, which has not happened a whole lot in the scriptures, and tells him, that night your soul is being required of you. Calls him from that life, from this life. And Jesus ends that by saying, this is the same end for all of those who are guilty of not being rich toward God. And all of God's people said, Now, I can tell, by the way, some of you are shifting and squirming in your seats and some of the looks on your faces. I think I know what you're thinking. Oh, Lord, Ken's going to talk about money this morning. Well, yes and no. Certainly, there are times when we have to talk about money. We ought to. And there are certainly some things about money and about our stewardship of what God has entrusted to our care that it's a part of this scripture, but it's not the whole picture. Dig a little bit deeper. There's something else going on in this passage. This is a passage that concerns not only our gifts, but the whole of our life, because I would put it to you that being rich toward God is not just a matter of your pocketbook and your checkbook. It is a way of life. It is a way of thinking. It is a way of honoring God and seeing the things of God in the whole of our lives. So what are we trying to understand in this parable? What's underneath the surface? I think we have to look at in the beginning and understand that what Jesus is doing here is not warning us that having money is a sin. Let me say that again. Jesus is not warning us here that having money is a sin. You have to understand there are some folks out there who have taken this parable and used it as evidence in their argument that having money, not such a good thing. I grew up in the Church of God. We were Pentecostal, a lot of good people, a lot of poor folks. And I knew a lot of well-intentioned but misinformed people that loved to sit back and rail about them folks that got everything. And they would often try to tell me that this Bible told us that money is the root of all evil. That is an incorrect reading of 1 Timothy 6:10. What does that say to us? It says to us that the love of money is the root of all evil. Money in and of itself is neutral. It can be used for good. It can be used for ill. The man in our parable is a wealthy guy. He's a farmer, wealthy farmer. We're not told that he gained his money illicitly. As a matter of fact, it sounds like he's a hardworking guy that's made good. So there's nothing wrong with the money in and of itself. As a matter of fact, we have to understand that we live in a world where it is important for us to have some material resources to live. To forget that truth, to forget that we are ultimately accountable to God for everything He gives to us, that we are called to be good stewards, to invest it wisely for our benefit and for God's glory, to forget that is a bigger problem than having money. There was a study that put out a while back that said that 85 out of 100 Americans have forgotten the importance of being good stewards. They have forgotten the importance of investing for their benefit and for God's glory, to prepare for their life ahead. And so by the time they reach 65, 85 out of 100 have less than $250 in savings. Now, who has a wrong attitude toward money? Somebody who's wise and invests what God gives to them so that God may be glorified and that they may look after themselves? Or is it somebody that has no regard for what God gives to them altogether? Money is not the real issue in this parable. Nor is the real issue, the big issue that Jesus is trying to teach us, nor is the big issue the sin of greed. Now, don't get me wrong. Greed is a real problem. It is a prevalent sin in the world in which we live. You see, I think Jesus wants us to understand that the hunger in every human heart can only be satisfied by the bread of heaven in Jesus. And yet so many around us are choosing to try to satiate their hunger with the bankrupt junk food of the endless pursuit of materialism. Mammon has become their god, not God. I read a real story about a divorce settlement some time back down in Florida. A couple had been married for 21 years. As part of the divorce settlement, this is what the ex-wife got. She was given enough money to fly from Florida to New York once a month to do her hair. She was given $2,600 a month to eat out. She had an ample allowance for gas and oil and upkeep of her $100,000 Mercedes, $10,000 for vacation, $1,500 a month for groceries. Why does she need groceries? And here's the great one right here. $20 a month to contribute to the church or charity of her choice. How's that for selflessness? Yeah, I think greed is a real problem. And it's not just for the jet set, friends. It is for everybody. David Henderson, in his book, Culture Shifts, says that America's number one tourist attraction, ahead of Disney World, and four times as many people as the Grand Canyon, is the Mall of America in Minneapolis, Minnesota. It's a shopping mall with 400 stores, an amusement park, and a full-size roller coaster. In 2011, the Mall of America drew 40 million visitors. Disney World drew 16.1. The Grand Canyon drew 4.2 million. Henderson writes that America is a nation of compulsive shoppers, and the mall has become our home away from home and our national pastime. Now, you can call me a cynic if you want to, but I don't think that the elite are summering in Minneapolis, Minnesota, as nice as it is. Apparently, this greed thing is a whole lot bigger problem than we realized. The truth of the matter is you can have a lot or you can have a little or somewhere in between, and you can still be greedy. Why? Because greed is a matter of the heart and the soul. It's a matter of short-sightedness. It's a matter of not understanding where your blessings come from. In the parable, we're not really told whether or not this farmer is a greedy guy. He shows some signs of it. But for all we know, he could have been a really generous guy. It's not told to us. And I think it's deliberately written that way because I think Jesus wants us to focus on something deeper here. So what is it? If we're not talking about this issue of having money or an issue of greed, what is it that we're really dealing with? I think that Jesus is trying to warn us here about the sin of being forgetful. Yeah, the guy had money, and he may have been greedy with it, but his real problem was that he was guilty of being forgetful. Now, forgetful, you're saying to yourself, how was he forgetful? Well, let's go to the record. How many times does this fellow mention himself? In two verses, he says the word I how many times? He says, what shall I do? For I have nowhere to store my crops. And he said, I will do this. I will put down my barns and build larger ones, and there I will store all of my grain and goods, and I will say to my soul, soul, you have ample goods for many years. I. This guy's got an eye problem. He never once thanked God for the blessings in his life. Did you notice that? He saw himself as being responsible for what came into his life, and he was going to decide what he would do with it. He was short-sighted. He didn't understand God was the giver and that we're responsible to God for what he gives us. He forgot that. And that kind of forgetfulness is still an ongoing problem. President Abraham Lincoln, in a proclamation for a setting aside of a day of prayer during the Civil War, wrote about this problem. And his words are as true for us here this morning as they were from when he wrote them. This is what he wrote. He said, intoxicated with unbroken success, we have become too self-sufficient for the necessity of prevenient and redeeming grace. We have become too proud to pray to the God that made us. We have seen our nation increase in power and in numbers and in wealth unlike any nation in the world, but we have forgotten God. Sound familiar to you? Ultimately, the farmer in our parable is guilty of forgetting that he's a creature with a finite life, but an eternal soul. A February 3rd, 2006 article in The Week talked about 12 American multimillionaires who think that they're going to cheat death. They're confident in the continued progress of medical science, and so they've arranged to have themselves cryogenically frozen so they can be thawed out and healed up when medical science catches up. Furthermore, they've set up what they call personal revival trusts in which they're putting their wealth so that when they are revived, they'll be just as wealthy as they were before, somewhere, you know, 100, 200 years in the future. The farmer in our parable and those guys in that article, they've done a good job of preparing themselves for comfort and for material security, but just like the farmer in the parable, those folks have forgotten to take care to prepare for the well-being of their souls. You understand what I'm saying to you here? The real sin of the farmer, the real sin, the real problem that we face, the real danger that you and I face is forgetting the fact that our eternal soul is worth more than creature comforts. And that our lives beyond this little space here and now are eternal, and we better get ready for it. That's the real danger that we face. And if we forget those things, it puts us on a path that ultimately leads us to our doom. See, we have to understand, there's nothing wrong with God's blessings in and of themselves, provided we get them honestly, invest them wisely, and use them for God's glory. Nothing wrong with that. But we must ultimately remember that we are accountable to God. We are rich toward God. We honor God when we remember we are accountable to God for what we do with everything he gives us, including our lives, our souls. And ultimately, we're going to have to answer to God for how we invest that for eternity. Dorothy Sayers wrote, essentially, Christianity teaches us that everything we do here rightly reflects what we eternally are. What we do here rightly reflects what we eternally are. What are we eternally this morning? What do our lives reflect that we are eternally? How are we being the good stewards that God has called us to be? Are we forgetting what God has done for us? Henry Ford once met an associate and asked the fellow what his goals were in life. And the fellow said, "I want to make $1 million. Mr. Ford nodded to him. A couple days later, he ran into the guy again, and Mr. Ford had a pair of glasses for him. Except he had taken the glasses and taken the glass out and put silver dollars where the glass was. And he told the man, "Put the glasses on." The man put them on. He said, "Tell me what you see." And the man said nothing because the dollars are in the way. Henry Ford then told the man, "Don't ever let money get in the way of your seeing the big picture." What is it that prevents us from seeing the big picture this morning? What is it that causes us to lose sight of what really counts, of what is rich toward God, of what has meaning for our lives into eternity? What is it that causes us to lose sight of that? What is it that causes us to forget that we are eternal beings, that we are called to prepare for a life beyond this and are accountable to God for how we do that? God, give us grace that we might live and move and have our being in such a way that we will never be guilty of the sin of forgetfulness. Thanks be to God. Amen. At this time, we prepare our hearts and minds for communion. We remind you that as United Methodists, we believe this is the table of the Lord. We don't have the right or the desire to turn anyone away from the table, though none of us are worthy of our own merits to gather the crumbs from beneath the table. The privilege of coming to this table as a child of God was bought for us at great price. What is required to come forward is to have a humble and a repentant heart, a desire to place God first in our lives, that we might honor God with all that we are and all that we have, that we might be rich toward Him. So at the appropriate time, we invite you to come as you feel led. The method we use here is intinction. We'll have some stations across the front here. You'll come forward. You'll be given a piece of bread. You'll be invited to dip in the chalice and receive communion, after which you may return to your seats or you may kneel at the altar for a time of prayer. On the night in which our Lord gave Himself up for us, He took bread and He gave thanks to you, and He broke the bread, and He gave it to His disciples, and He said, "Take, eat, this is My body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of Me." When the supper was over, He took the cup. He gave thanks to you. He gave it to His disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is My blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of Me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by His blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at His heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. We'll invite those who've been asked to help serve and our praise team to come forward. Susie, the body of Christ broken for you. The blood of Christ. Table is set. We invite you to come, taste, and see that the Lord is good.
Thank you.
God, look on His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.
Beloved, remember that you are a child of the living God, that God has blessed you out of His abundance and has for each of you a future and a hope. Remember that as we live into that with the grace of God, that we honor God in all that we say and do. Go forth to do that this week. God bless you. I love you. Remember all that's going on. Until we are together again, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
Above all powers, above all kings.